But the organizer actually asked me to do a brief summary of what you just told us, but I think it's not necessary. After listening to Yuyan's talk, I finally, I'm convinced that the cardboard collecting uncles and aunties are not doing what they do in this class. Next, let's welcome Professor CJV Wan-Ling, who asked for an additional 10 minutes for him to get some video clips to show us.
First, a sort of snapshot of the some key things in Singapore's history that we might map what I'm trying to suggest against. From 1959 to the 70s, and before that, we have, of course, the Cold War, first in the shape of the Malayan Emergency, 1948 to 1960, and then Vietnam right through to the 70s. And then an important moment, which I should have put here but I didn't, collapse of the Mao regime and the emergence of Deng Xiaoping and reform in 78, which is sort of a line that defines a moment of change for Kuo Pao Kun's life and his work. And part of the issue of a multiracial society went hand in hand with the Cold War issues. Certainly as development meant that multiracial complexity had to be contained so that standardization and modernization could be achieved in Singapore. So, here's some information on his detention, which is always referred to, but not much information is given. He was arrested on the 17th of March, but it looks like it wasn't actually reported by the Straits Times until 28th May, so quite a bit later. And you can see he's part of that 70s period. There are these splinter groups of the Malayan Communist Party, which TND can probably tell you much more than I can, so I won't attend that. But he was arrested for being a member of that. Other people were arrested. You can see that they indicated that he went to a training camp at the edge of southern Thailand. I won't go through the detail. Obviously, these are allegations. He was not put on trial. I'm not in a position to comment on it. But that edition of the Straits Times pretty much has the stuff plastered over 3-4 pages, along with the detention, the arrest and detention of his wife, Goh Lay Kuan. So the practice theatre school you see in the third paragraph is the school that Kuo Pao Kun and Lay Kuan founded upon their return from Australia from their training there. So how do we think of this period? The 60s and 70s and its transition into the 80s are very, very important sort of consideration for Kuo Pao Kun. It transformed his art, and yet I want to suggest, and I think we can see some continuities as well. It's interesting because we forget that the mid-70s in Singapore was still quite, in certain aspects, tumultuous. There was a bomb blast in, was it Katong somewhere? Was it in Katong? Yeah, Katong car was blown up with the amnesiacs, right? We forget that this actually, that I remember I gave a presentation on Singapore theatre, and the man who introduced, who was the Okie Okie, he apologized to the attendees of the conference that Singapore is a very boring place. I think we forget. I don't think it was all that boring. So, the car bombs going up in Gatun can't be all that boring. So anyway, that's just what I think. So, the interesting thing and the important thing about Kuo Pao Kun is that the detention in 76 comes at a point where Mao dies, the Gang of Four fall, and Deng Xiaoping slowly come into power and comes into power, and the reforms kick off. So his work, Kuo Pao Kun's work in the 60s, 70s, of course, drew from the social realist tradition of Chinese theatre, where art was less important than the politics. But for Kuo Pao Kun, even in the 60s and 70s, art was important. He brought in, he translated and staged production of Bertolt Brecht's Caucasian Joke Circle. It was criticized by the Chinese intelligentsia for doing this because Brecht was seen as bourgeois. But Kuo Pao Kun's response is, do I care? So, you know, so even then, while he was doing social realist theater, he was not simply a social realist. But the thing that he registers here is that as he goes into detention, the questions occur with the horrors of the Cultural Revolution becoming more apparent. How do we think of the Cultural Revolution? So the important thing here is that in detention, he starts to rethink his theatre work. and he starts to think about the issue of art. And here's a quite important reflection on his part while he's in detention. And he rethinks Lucian's essay, The Diverging Path of Politics and Culture. Actually, he gets the date wrong. It's a 1927 address to some military academy in China. I can't remember the details. And as he thinks through Lucian, rethinks Lucian, what he learns, what he thinks, is that progressive politics and progressive art cannot be simply yoked together. Why? Because of power is power. So in other words, whether it's left-wing power or right-wing power, power likes power. And of course, in that context, he tries to think about art having autonomy. Now, obviously, he doesn't simply become some bourgeois artist and talks about the self, I, me, myself, and my inner beings. He doesn't become some bourgeois modernist, you know, in the way he thinks. But so artistic autonomy becomes a very specific thing, but it just never becomes bourgeois self-fulfillment. Because art is always, first of all, to do with truth. If politics is the consequence of art, so be it. Because art and truth are the key thing. Now, Lucian himself, of course, is an extremely complicated figure, ambivalent, claimed by Mao, but of course, never joined the Chinese Communist Party, was never a cadre in the regime, and all this was, his own ambivalence is what Kuo Pao Kun draws from. And here's an excerpt in English from this famous Lu Xun essay that Kuo Pao Kun refers to. So, yet politics tends to remain in the status quo, so it naturally stands in the opposite direction of art, which is discontented with reality. Art brought forth ruptures, but only through ruptures could society progress. So there you are, see, it's progressive, but it doesn't necessarily have to be linked to party politics. Since art is a thorn in the eyes of the politician, it had to be eliminated. So what we see as Kuo Pao Kun exits 70s into 80s is a transition, a very severe rethink of his work with yet continuities from his earlier social realist theatre. And here's a reflection of this in an interview with Jack Yung in 1992 in his mature phase. And it's clear here that he has become critical of the Cultural Revolution, and he wants a here in his mature articulation of art. So that art first and foremost has to be art. Even if you want to be very political, you still have to be first and foremost artistic. So he's moved very sharply away from the May 4th tradition, and this notion of art is sustained by him right through to the end of his life, literally. As we enter, therefore, into the 1980s, he comes out into a Singapore that is markedly different from the Singapore of 1965 to 1979-1980, as he's released in 1980. And what happens is that, of course, with the arrest of quite a number of theatre figures, Chinese theatre suddenly comes to a halt. English language theatre is starting to pick up in the 80s as he steps forward. And the thematics change, and necessarily so from his point of view. The 1990s, he says, has the issue of reflections of identity and a reflection of these years of independence and economic nation building that the state has been moving forward with. And you know, as you come to the 80s, Singapore, I think, is quite established. It's not some poverty-stricken, or Singapore's never been a poverty-stricken country in the sort of Indian sense. You know, it's never quite that grinding poverty. Malayan tin and Malayan rubber always made Singapore wealthier than many other of the British colonies. But he's able to distinguish, right? During the Cold War, we don't care about culture. We want to know whose side you are. Culture, what rubbish is that? Are you East and West did not mean culture, it meant red or capitalist, right? So it was a nonsensical question to deal with culture. culture that really the Cold War. But as you come to the 80s, Singapore changes, they're not nonsensical questions because Singapore's economic development is based on the suppression of clashing cultural diversities, political standardization of civil society, the creation of factories, etc., etc., etc. So, his art changes because Singapore has changed as well. The world has changed. And he, therefore, one reason why you just can't have the external relations of social realism is that he starts to see that the individual also matters. Again, this does not mean he becomes bourgeois. But nevertheless, he is aware that how the person thinks is important. When he says, well, which one comes first, I don't know. So if you think of his monologues, Coffin is too big for the hole or no parking on days, you're giving insight to the thinking of the protagonist who, in grappling with his traditional responsibilities in terms of Coffin is too big for the hole, engages with the standardized nature of Singapore society, you know, that there's this huge Chinese coffin, you can't go into the standardized hole. The individual deals with how he tries to fulfill his traditional ideas in the present. How do you do that, given the new standardized world that we live in? Right? So here's an indication of some of the plays of that period, of the key period of his life, right through this British play, which is his last major play. I mean, he does do plays after that, but it's his last major play, I think, very important play. I'll return to that. So, what happens there? In the standardized social engineer flattened out diversity contained because of fear of interracial conflagration. By the way, this is something Kuo Pao Kun never rubbishes. He doesn't deride that. His critique of that is, and that's where the multiculturalism comes in, is that operating on this Cold War period, fear of interracial strife stops the possibility for intercultural development. So it's not that he rejects, he doesn't say racial conflagration is nonsense, obviously you would not have said that, right? It's a question of how you deal with it. So he, in this world, he has come to the point where he rejects May 4th style theatre, because the May 4th style theatre that he was doing was actually anti-tradition and itself a form of social engineering, pro-flattening out the complexity of the past, right? Interestingly enough, as he engages with the present and with this homogenized world, or increasingly homogenized world of Singapore, he brings back tradition, but he wants different types of tradition to rethink how we might live in the present. So here he's speaking about Lao Tzu, and Lao Tzu is a story of a boy in an exam system, Singapore's exam system, who is so pressured by the system, he runs off to a puppet master, and sort of finds escape in the traditional puppet forms. Now I'll just show you extracting theatre works version.
The artist is the puppet master.
his own mise-en-scène, were through his body alone. And then the multiculturalism works. He could be accused of essentialism, but he doesn't actually quite do that. It's sort of multiculturalism is suggested that maybe roots at the bottom that are similar for sort of a tree and leaves that overlap. So there are sort of similar impulses within regional theatre. So he's not a universalist, he is a humanist, but he's not a universalist because also he is contesting sort of Western theatrical traditions as they go into the May 4th tradition of modern theatre. So, in this sense, he engages with the past, but he doesn't reject the possibilities of the present as well. And one thing that surprises people, if you look at this particular quotation, is that he thinks in many ways that the information society has its positives, right? Because the head is used, because communication is possible in a sort of accelerated form, and because the head is so much is used, in some ways emphasizes the need for theater as a space for the body. Therefore, he holds a sort of complicated position where it's sort of both and at the same time. Yeah. As we come into the 90s, why Kuo Pao Kun, why Kuo is dealing with these things as well, is because there is a transition. There is a transition away from sort of standardized modernization into what is now is Singapore's a sterile city of shopping centers, no culture. In the 70s, you know, cultural desert, as even the government administrators describe Singapore. Obviously, there's been a switch in the way Singapore positions culture as part of its standing as a global city. Now, in the early 90s, this wasn't quite particularly obvious. But Kuo Pao Kun, by this stage, has his famous cultural orphan pronouncements, right? So if you're cut off, you can't return. Can't return. And it's not simply because of the stage social engineering aspects of Singapore life that's cut off the roots. That's one thing. But another thing is that he thinks that what Singapore has, of course, are migrant societies. You don't mean the complexity of the entire South Asian continent or subcontinental China, that sort of thing, obviously. So it's fractured anyway. So from his point of view, that's why it's not nostalgic. There's no turning back. There's no turning back. And in response to the new sort of IT, knowledge-based economy language is starting to emerge in Singapore, by the 1990s, he starts to think that, okay, once again, the government talks of these terms with no reference to culture. There always is a new set of technocratic terms. But the issue here is that if you want to talk about these terms, what these terms mean, there must be culture involved. It just can't be consumption. Consumption is something else he's deeply critical of. And here is where he does his own intercultural thing, because the point is, at this stage, can you be rooted in any culture? Can you be rooted in any culture? So his work has this fine sort of balancing act where there's always the element of the at least quasi-tragic and the possibilities and the enabling possibilities of a new technology by which communication is enabled. And when we come to Descendants of the Eunuch Admiral in 1995, his work has changed. He uses the eunuch as a myth for the person that Zheng He, Zheng Ho, you know, Muslim but cut off serving the Han state, yet he gains his freedom when he's outside the, of course, it's an anachronistic national state, where he represents his great power outside China, he's free. And he's able to see the world representing the Ming dynasty at its very height. But he's within the system. So if you see that as an allegory, and it's very interesting, because what he does is that he sees the Singapore condition as a global allegory by that stage. Yeah? He sees the Singapore condition as a global allegory. Then there's no escape, but within the framework of that system, you have to find space. So there's no transcendence in this world. The truth element dealing with the world as it is remains there consistently, even in the world that's more globalized space. And what a world it is compared to the 1970s when he's detained, right? A very different world. How then can we see the last phase of his life? And unfortunately, was cut off here before he could finish it. At this stage, the last major play, from my point of view anyway, that he wrote is The Spirit's Play. And The Spirit's Play is a very interesting play which again got into trouble with not only Singapore Chinese community, but with sort of Chinese communities outside Southeast Asia, Hong Kong, Taiwan. He wrote The Spirit's Play where he represented Japanese souls, the term Japan, Nippon, all that is never used in a play, trapped on this island, constantly reliving the past, trapped and abused by their own country. So there's sympathy for the trapped souls that were being manipulated by the nation state, by the forces of nationalism. He is criticized, of course, for being sympathetic to the Japanese. And when it was staged by Danny Yung, I think, in Hong Kong, was criticized, then Sato Makoto, Black Tail Theatre tried to stage it in Japan, and the Japan Foundation basically said no. So he offended everyone. So it must be doing something right. At this stage, he was in Japan in 1997 on the Japan Foundation Asia Center Leadership Fellowship, I believe. And here, again, as you can see, this is from his reflections. He draws a certain set of reflections from his stay in Japan as he explores Japan in a couple of these pieces. Here he starts to think of how Japan itself doesn't quite exceed, hasn't quite become modern. But it's not only Japan. Japan is part of a larger set of problems within the region where we are still trapped in hierarchical and patriarchal systems. And therefore, from his point of view, nationalism remains, even in the late 90s, early 2000s, a bad thing. He's not a nationalist. So what else is a problem with Japan? Here's the issue of autonomy as well, that the Japanese, from his point of view, don't do autonomous thinking. Japan seems to verge close to a statement, close to a statement made by Singapore architect Tay Kheng Soon, modernization without modernity, a comment he coined for his own country, Singapore's Kheng Soon, so a great one phrase about Singapore. So there's the process of the sort of mental freedom, mental mess, as it were, that modernism as an art had, but modernity, sort of more industrial capitalist forces, may not have fostered. There's a sort of balance between the two, that modernism is an art that emerges within the emergence of Western modernity and contests it, even though modernist art itself is committed to innovation, the new and new art forms and all that. But this is what he says. Yars suggests that this is what is missing, the notion of what modernity was in its larger concept, the notion of liberation of the self, the democratization of society, and the realization of the knowledge-based mode of production and exchange. And it's very interesting because he jumps from the notion of what modernity was, the mission of modernity, if you think of the German intellectual Jürgen Habermas. And then he's slowly trying to link this against the new sort of diverse forces of global production industrial system that is sort of dumping that standardized frame of thinking and maybe reducing that notion of the individual. So as he's starting to think about this map against the region, which is still, from his point of view, unfreed self, still moored in badly, of course, the hierarchy and patriarchy, he passes away. And it's very interesting that, and perhaps ironic in an unintended way, that the year he passes away, 2002, is the year that the Esplanade Theatres in the Bay is open and culture in Singapore becomes economy. This is not to rubbish the work of Tommy Koh or the in championing it, that's very important, but Kuo Pao Kun constantly said to the end, culture cannot be subject to the dictates of the economy. Thank you.